Hi, everybody. Welcome to Popdust Presents. I'm your host, Brent Butler, and tonight I'm here with Bear Rinehart of Wilder Woods.
That's right. I'm here.
How you doing, man?
I'm great. How are you?
Very good. It's actually very cool to have you here because your new project, Wilder Woods, I think a lot of people know you from Need to Breathe.
Yeah, I was a drummer in that band.
And now you have, I believe, your first, like the first full LP coming out in
August 9th. Yeah.
And then a tour following that up in September.
Yeah.
So that's very exciting. What should we know about the album?
It's a different thing. If you're a fan of Need to Breathe, you might or might not like it. So I think it's a total departure, you know, for me. And it's been a lot of fun. The most fun I've had making music in a long time, just because it's fresh and I didn't have any sort of, I kind of feel like I'm playing with house money in a way, you know? And the tour isn't going to be insane. I've got a band, with me that I'm like pretty stoked about, piano player that played with D'Angelo, and he sort of put the band together. So that tells you a little bit about what it might sound like. So I'm just excited to kind of like see that thing take its life.
And is that the band that we just experienced playing here?
That is most of them. There's a guy missing, but yes.
Do we know where he is? Is he okay?
I don't know. He's on that flight. No, he's a bass player. So,
okay. Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
So
perfect. Definitely check out the videos of their performances here at the Popdust offices if you haven't already. And that's exciting. And then what do you have planned for the tour?
Well, we have like 35 minutes of music, which is a challenge when you have one record to make an hour and a half show or whatever. So that's going to be the thing. And so we'll do some covers like we did here and some stretched out things. We'll do a little, I think we were talking about doing some Childish Gambino, some like, you know, just kind of random stuff. Definitely. For me. So I'm like, if we can, in the hour and whatever it is, if we can just stop the music only two times where I talk about a song or something.
I was actually like, going to advocate that you just kind of ramble a lot.
I should talk.
That's how I get through most of my days.
It does add a lot of time.
I just start talking. Mm-hmm. I don't even know what I'm going to say.
Right.
And I just keep going. And then before you know it, it's tomorrow.
Okay. Well, we can do that. I don't know. I just got off an acoustic tour where I did talk a lot about the songs and stuff. So I'm kind of over that right now. I'm ready to just, you know, get to the music.
Great. Good time to have you for an interview when you're just done with talking about your music.
No, I would love to talk about myself, but my music is, yeah. Okay. So just continue to do that.
This new project, why did you decide to go in this direction? And obviously you're saying that you're having a lot of fun. For fans of Need to Breathe, what is it that might be different and what might they look forward to?
You know, as a band, I love the band, but I always was like, what if I collaborated with some different people? And I wonder what's out there and kind of like, I also kind of like, what am I capable of in a different scenario? And so I think that the scheduling made it possible, honestly. That sounds like kind of, I don't know, technical, but the truth is like the band used to play 150 shows a year probably. And now it's like 50, you know, we play bigger shows and we play less. And so it opened up some time where I could like really start thinking about it and writing music for it. And I think that's really what kind of like turned me on about it. I started writing songs for it and they were weird and not, you know, I knew they weren't Need to Breathe songs. Yeah. So it's like, okay, they need to land somewhere. I don't know where. And you know, we found sort of the Wilderwood sound during that whole process.
Is this correct? Because this looked wrong to me. Possum Kingdom?
That's correct. Totally correct.
That's a real place.
Is a real place. There's actually two of those places, believe it or not. There was a band a long time ago in the 90s, I think, called Toadies.
Oh, I know the Toadies.
Yeah, and they had a song called Possum Kingdom. It was a lake in Texas. I'm not from that lake. I'm from a smaller town than that, 100 people in South Carolina.
Possum Kingdom, South Carolina. Do you feel like it's had an impact on your music, your sound, and or message?
I think it does. I think that we really fought when we first signed the band did years ago. It's like we fought against this like anything that sounded country, you know. I think we thought like, oh, we'll be international sounding, you know. And we actually went to England to make our first record. And then I realized like a few records in, it's like it's something you can't shake. You just have some of that stuff. Like we grew up in like the sort of like gospel churches that are like the real music, you know? And I think that stuff is in us. And so even on this record, I feel like it like plays in that way in terms of like harmonies and the things that I loved about like Ray Charles and Otis Redding and all those people that grew up in a church singing songs. I mean, I think that stuff still plays.
Are there people that you consider influences that maybe fans would not expect?
Yes. I mean, I grew up, you know, with a lot of like early 90s R&B was a big part of my life. Right. You know what I mean? Rap was the first couple of Outkast records. That stuff was like classic. Easily as like, so it like in my car, probably in high school, it would have been, you know, Outkast and the Black Crowes maybe. So it's like not similar at all and just kind of wide. So on this record, I think I got a chance to visit some of the like weirder, not weirder, but just things I haven't had a chance to do, you know? So like we would take a song that's like kind of a classic soul song. We'd be like, what if it had the groove from like Coolio or whatever, you know, like what if a Genuine or something like that.
Yeah.
And then like slow that down and make it sort of trippy and, you know, modern. So I think a lot of that stuff, so a lot of the songs the same song would have a reference of like the guitar should sound like Isaac Hayes and the beat should sound like Coolio and the vocal sounds like Jim James from, you know, My Morning Jacket or something like that.
One of the things that we should probably cover is where is the tour planning to head?
We go to Europe, at the end of it, but America, we're doing Troubadour in LA and, you know, we're playing here, Brooklyn. So it'll be fun. It's going to be fun. I mean, for me, the band's like playing really big venues now. So it's like playing clubs again is going to be a blast, I think.
Absolutely. And that's cool. And you're going to go international with it as well.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's been like a big plan. I've wanted to do that. I've been over there a bunch, but to take a project like new and fresh over there, it's going to be fun.
You mentioned, you know, Outkast earlier, and some other people from maybe like R&B and hip hop in the 90s. Should we expect a collaboration?
That would be a dream of mine.
Some Andre 3 Stacks.
That would be
on a Wild
out
Woods
of control,
track.
For real.
Honestly, he's a big fan of the show.
I don't think that's like crazy, yeah.
So Andre, or Big hey. Boy, honestly, hey, we did an interview with Big Boy, actually. He apparently throws
Call me.
A great Halloween party every year in Atlanta. Maybe we just crashed that party. We talked to him. We explained, you guys are both from down south.
That could work. That's how it works. That's how the music business works.
Actually, could you for people that are out there who are songwriters and musicians that really want to break into the industry and do things, you know, you've obviously been a part of multiple groups now, Grammy nominated and everything. What advice would you give? How do you actually break in other than crashing Big Boy's Halloween party?
It's hard. It's hard when you first start out because you think you want to conquer the world, and this is like, I mean, this just like when, but really what you need to do is sell 100 tickets in some random city. So it could be Philadelphia or Boston or whatever. And in order to do that, you don't need everybody in the world to like your band. You just need the weirdos to like your band. You just need the people that you're focused on. And I think that's probably the hardest thing for bands to do, is to kind of narrow it down and go like, I just need all the left-handed, you know, people that drive BMWs, whatever. It's like, whatever, just like make it way smaller of an audience that you're going for.
And how do you decide who that focused audience is? Is it like, you know, just, is it somebody that you imagine like, this is who I'm writing for?
I think it has to do with like, you don't necessarily have a choice with that as easily. I think,
a lot of people naturally want to go big and broad and wide, and they're like, I should have wide mass appeal.
Yeah.
And if they say, well, who really is, who is it that you're writing for? And that's not only with music, it's with any like industry.
Sure.
Where you're like creating something.
Obviously with music, I think we're looking for connection. Like, and you, so to have that, I think you have to have some things in common. I think it's really hard for you to be like, you know, it's just, I don't know, to be outside of yourself. And so the stuff that you talk about, it needs to be something you've lived. And that's what really connects with people. You know, I have a, like, I wouldn't say it's a theory, but it's just like this thing where I feel like everybody's sort of tapped into that connection sometimes, and sometimes they're disconnected from it, and songs are the things a lot of times. It may be a conversation, might be somebody else, but they help them sort of connect back to whatever that is, you know, yep. That home, you know, that feeling of like, I belong here, you know? And so in order to do that, you have to be able to talk to that person. So it's easier than it seems, I think. It's just maybe like at the beginning, you're sort of denying who you are or something like that. So I think the sooner bands know that, sooner artists know that, the better.
I think that's great advice. So before we wrap it up, is there anything else that you might want to let people know about?
Come see the show. Give it a chance. It's going to be rad. I can't wait.
Awesome. Thank you so much for being here at Popdust.
Thanks for having me.